eSportBets.com. Уникальное место для настоящего геймера. Только здесь возможны ставки на киберспортивные события. Ты знаешь толк в самых популярных играх и готов рисковать? Смотри регулярные трансляции и зарабатывай реальные деньги. eSportBets.com. Живой азарт и холодный расчет.
Alright, and with that, welcome back to the stream. This is Room on Fire, and we are about to be witnessing LDLC.com versus ESG. I know it says Reason Gaming on top, but don't worry about that. It'll be switched out soon enough. You're here watching Counter-Strike Global Offensive SLTV Starseries Season 10, and with me, as always, of course, is going to be Semler. What's up, Semler?
Again, perfect timing. Newbie just managed to tie it up 1-1 right now in the series.
Damn.
So, two monitors, man. I'm taking full advantage. I got the game on one, and I got the TI4 finals on the other. But holy hell, what a game. Yeah, this is fantastic. Even when, you know, EG, they can't quite make it through. I was hoping we would have, like, a Western team versus a Chinese team. Even with the Chinese finals, this is so exciting.
Excellent. Yes, of course, you know, the International 4 is in its final stage, the Grand Finals. But those of you who aren't watching, who chose to join us here tonight, we really do appreciate it. Great that you guys want to hang out and watch some Counter-Strike with us. You know, sort of a casual evening here, SLTV Best of One games. But we are enjoying ourselves, and we've been seeing some fun action already. But I think the fun is about to stop for a lot of people here, because, I mean, this is going to be a pretty tough matchup, I think, for both teams. I would say LDLC are actually favorites coming into this game, but yeah, it's really hard to judge based on the last couple of games we've seen. You know, LDLC beating Reason, okay. ESG actually just had a game against Onbots, which they won, but it was 16-13 on Mirage, which is a map that Onbots are really good on. So again, and Onbots are not a bad team, so it's kind of hard to say how this is all going to turn out. I think, you know, being on Dust 2, it could just come down to whoever has the best start.
Agreed. This is definitely a momentum sort of map situation that we're looking at here, because either of these teams are capable of just running away with rounds. We saw just a great performance in the first match of the night between ESG and USSR. USSR had a strong start, but then ESG, they got the reins of the match and they never let him go. They just steamrolled USSR past that point. Now LDLC, obviously, you know, a bit higher tier than USSR, but still, at this point, I think this is one of those situations where ESG are just going to play better, because they have more information on LDLC. LDLC being a more experienced team and also being one of the top teams in the world right now, they play a certain way that ESG, I think, it's gonna allow ESG to bring out their better game. So my real question right now is whether ESG are gonna be able to handle the aggression that we've been seeing from LDLC. If LDLC decide to play their game, cut Apex loose, let him run wild on the map, along with Kaylee, along with Uzi, are ESG gonna be able to handle that with the likes of Delpan and Michaelele?
That's the thing. I mean, if you cut Apex and Kaylee loose, then what happens if ESG cut Delpan and Michaelele loose? I mean, almost, this could just be a really crazy game with a lot of aggression, or it could come down to you know, opening Kaylee versus Delpan. Definitely not a boring matchup, and slightly different styles as well. I think like Kaylee is maybe a little bit more cautious with his opening, but he hits some very important shots, and Delpan sometimes takes, you know, some huge risks, and if they pay off, great. If they don't, well, I mean, LDLC, they don't really need a second chance. They'll, if one mistake from Delpan, and I think he's going to be gone, basically.
I really feel like it's a kind of a confidence thing for Kaylee, because he's one of those players who's absolutely capable of like, walking out and playing very aggressive opping, like, very aggressive with the op. But he needs to land a few shots first before we start seeing him really do that.
Yeah.
Whereas Delpan is definitely a guy who will just, you know, like the first time he buys an op, we can expect him, if he's on the CT side, right, to just go out mid doors and look for a pick. Like, exactly. He has no fear. So it's cool to see how Kaylee's style kind of changes, evolves as the game progresses. If he really starts hitting shots and gets comfortable just holding angles, letting him walk into his crosshair, then he starts to get a bit more adventurous. If it comes down to that, though, that's something that I think, like, ESG have the advantage when it comes to sniping, because they also have Michaelele, and Michaelele does not mess around with that AWP. That was a big question when Delpan was first added to the team. It's like, okay, you know, how are they going to handle this? Because Michaelele's been opping for the team so far before Delpan joined up, you know, with a little bit of help from PETA. But, like, Michaelele has shown that he is actually pretty damn good with the AWP. So that's something that LDLC are going to have to worry about, the fact that they may run into double snipe setups, you know, left and right.
Yeah, you're absolutely right. But there is one thing to say about that, though, which is that we've seen in the past how lineups that have multiple uppers become... It's just a condition that has to be fulfilled that you actually have money to buy the orbs. So, I mean, it's kind of a small point to bring up. But I guess, you know, if ESG start off with a bad start and they never really can't afford those AWPs, we do mm-hmm. see even really strong orping teams end up in a weird position. But you are right. Double orb setup, and it seems to be the sort of theme of the day. We've been seeing Dust 2 all day, and it's been double orb all the time almost, so why not?
Right now, yeah, it's... Well, we have all five... we have all five players for each team, let's say. We have all 10 players on the server.
Yes. But, and actually, just to quickly interrupt here, we did actually hit 130,000 subscribers as well. Or followers, not subscribers. If we had 130,000 subscribers, man, we would be bringing you guys some different quality action here. But we're thankful for the 130,000 followers as well. We really appreciate it. And big thanks to all of you. A new landmark for us. And obviously, the goal for us is to just get as high on the list as possible. And we'll try and do what we can in return to get more and more cool content back. And starting... with the second week of the Case King of the Hill tournament, which is going to be on Wednesday, called by Alpenfoon as well. Remember to check out the link at the bottom of the stream. You can participate in the raffle. But for now, we're actually live for the ninth round. So welcome to the show, everyone. This is SLTV Star Series Season 10. If you're watching from a YouTube VOD, then welcome as well. And thanks for joining our YouTube. The link to that is also at the bottom of the stream. But here it comes, the French versus the Swedes. And right now, it seems like it's going to be the Frenchmen starting off on one side or the other. Mikey Lenny not really respecting the rules of combat here. But Happy is still... What? Okay.
What
oh, I have no idea. I'm assuming it's still going to be LDLC swapping. I think that was Michael Eddy's just way of saying we're not going to be doing this.
Yeah. We stay T. We want it.
What a troll. Like, maybe it's like a psychological move, just throwing them off early on, you know, making sure they're a little bit scared. This man is crazy.
I like Apex. Like, I'm sure that you were funny, Michael Eddy. Like...
I put the chat off because I don't want anyone, that's like a security measurement. I'll explain later. Now we are ready. LDLC starting on the CT side, and the rush is coming into the B bomb site where Uzi can just kind of watch outside. Maybe he can get a pick off of somebody here, but jumping through, not going to be easy. And now he has to call for backup and wait it out. So let's see. This worked. Not for reason. They got the same push up almost, but they lost the bomb site. Mike Lilly is in a cool position, and especially with Emilio here drawing the attention away. Opening up is Mike Lilly, and then a kill, but this is just trading back and forth, and Hritten pushing up aggressively. This is madness coming out here from both teams. Team ESG not defending the bomb, just rushing out into the face of Happy, and is going to be alone in a 1-on-2, so maybe it works. Semla, what is this craziness?
He gets back out alive, though. That's the big thing for Roke. He didn't stick around, and Happy gets a great kill, but he's got his back to Roke. Roke not taking advantage of it. He misses his opportunity if Happy gets this kill now. This would be big, but I just don't think there's enough time. Even if he does, it's done. The bomb goes boom, and ESG, everything goes right that round. It doesn't even matter that it turns into a fist fight and that they lose members left and right. Everybody, in fact, ESG actually managed to get the right call, go for an aggressive push up of B, get into that site. And that was playing into what you were mentioning in the last map versus with LDLC, where they went for the same strat in the pistol round. And this is pretty much how it breaks down. You know, that if you can't execute the retake,
yeah,
that's not going to work out for you, LDLC.
And I think if LDLC had got control of Upper Dark a lot more, if they had killed the two people up there and moved in from both, you know, Door and Dark, that's what we've seen the retake be the most effective. It would have been a little bit different. Though, I like this setup here. Look at Kaylee and Apex up on Catwalk. This is a good idea, especially with Uzi and Happy pushing up Upper Dark. ESG got to be a little bit careful they don't get sort of sandwiched in, but they actually make some noise. I'm wondering if Rogue heard that Deagle shot, because if he did... they're probably going to be a little bit more weary. But we'll see. You know, in Global Offensive, we've seen a lot of turnarounds in these anti-ecos, and pretty important for ESD to not let anything go right now. Maniac spotting with the knife here, just trying to strafe as fast as he can. He spots a couple of people, and now they're going to be pushing up the middle where Delpan is holding, and he's got to be careful here. They're pushing from a lot of angles.
Yeah, they are, and this is a pistol armor buy. A couple of them have picked up the helmet armor for LDLC, so they can at least take a bit of a fight. But right now, it's going to be Hoiten on long, catches the first one, Maniac is down. Now it's going to be Apex on the A site, Michael Lele clicking away, finds him at range with the help of Delpan, and now Kaylee up close with the 5-7, nearly gets two. But this is now the point where it starts to fall apart here until Uzi steps in with the CZ.
Yeah, the work that Kaylee did was enough, Mikey Lilly, with a good headshot, but Uzi's still here. Even if they win this round, ESG, this is still a really, really good round from LDLC. Terrific work, and I think Kaylee, even though when you got the one kill, has to be credited with softening up the two next for Uzi. Even the three next, I think. So Uzi with the triple right now, Mikey Lilly obviously has the advantage, but there is armor on Uzi. Not sure that matters when he has got this little health, and Mikey Lilly is smartly waiting here. No kit on Uzi either, and he should be going down. He will be going down, but... this is a huge success for LDLC. Very nicely played.
That was fantastic. The fact that they did so much economic damage, that was insane. Picking up four like that. Uzi also with only like three bullets left in his CZ at the end. So you're really just thinking 17 points of health, three bullets left. It's not looking likely. He almost gets the one dig as well when he swaps out the pistols.
I think that was... there was every chance, I think, that Kaylee could have just died without doing any damage, and this would have been a great round for ESG. They would have probably just won it from there, but, you know, the fact that they took just 2 seconds longer than they should have to kill him meant they gave the opening, and he took it right away, so just very nice. Goes down, Apex waiting on top here with the USP without a silencer on for no real reason, though a great deagle from Happy is going to take down one player, and ESG need to keep the rest alive here. Pretty important that they don't give up any more rifles, but this grenade is going to take down Dilpan. Boom! And now it's back into a 2-on-2. LDLC are really bringing their A-game, it feels like. Another grenade rains in. Emilio is going to go down, and that leaves Quithen alone, and he's being double-teamed. He gets dropped, and LDLC retake the site, and that was not a reasonable defense coming out from ESG, I would say.
Unreal. Unreal that they actually managed to pull that off. That's in large part due to the nades onto the site, but also Happy getting two kills with the deagle. That is just disgusting. Great play there from LDLC. The fact that they do manage to come back and actually pick up the round. So I was about to say, like, they're dealing so much damage to ESG that ESG are going to be hard-pressed in this round to come up with a reasonable buy, and we can see right now it's a mix. There's only three guns on this side, two pistols, handful of nades. Like, ESG, they've suffered so much. But LDLC now, they're sterling. They've got everything going for them. If they can shut down this round, we could see them run away with this game.
Yeah, pushing out onto long, though, and LDLC moving quite smartly right now, just making sure they don't take the fight up close, because that would be just silly. They take down the first player in Mikey Lilly, and now, well... the pit is there, and actually Delpan's down in it. Emilio in the middle picking up a kill, but LDLC, they still have a good chance of making it back in this round.
Yeah, good sneak. Apex with the spray, gets Roke, drops the bomb as well. That's going to slow things down here for ESG. We're into a 3-on-3 now, and a good boost up from Apex is going to manage to get him onto that A site. They're really looking to see if anybody's going to be coming from Cat. They still have a man floating, LDLC that is, Happy over on that B site. And Happy is starting to get curious. He's like, he's looking into upper dark, he's trying to catch eyes.
There, Maniac really low on health, 40 seconds left still, and things are looking a little bit better for ESG, but they're making some really weird decisions here. Now, Maniac going to be charging out, the bomb is trying to be planted here, it will go down, but Quithen has no idea, he's getting double teamed, and Emilio, don't think he can even stop this, this is a round that ESG should have won without a question. Some really horrible mistakes throwing it away here.
That was all over the place.
That wasn't even like LDLC doing anything really clever to win that round. It was just, first of all, Emilio missing the kill in CT spawn, and then them choosing, like, basically not to cover the bomb properly.
It's just Emilio not being able to get over there to support Quithen, I think, towards the end there at least. But also just it being such a dirty fight. Every round, it seems, you know, we're just coming down to the point where it's 1v1, 2v2. Doesn't really seem like anybody is able to really just lock it down. They're just dropping bodies left and right, and that's not going to help. Well, I mean, it makes life pretty difficult when ESG don't come out on top of the pile, right?
For them, it does. Yeah, for LDLC, they're going to be pretty happy right now that they've ended up in that situation, because, I mean, they actually think they should have won the round even earlier, but ESG managed to fight their way back into an advantageous position, and then... it just feels like once they're in that position, they make some very, very bad mistakes, and then they just throw it away, which is not a good sign for them leading into the rest of this first half. Though Apex goes down, and there's that good start again. Now comes the decision-making point, and that's where it gets really tough here. Uzi flashing in, Happy's in this really good position. Last time he was here against Reason, he got a great double kill, just had the perfect timing for it. We'll see if it's going to work again. They are creeping in, and both Uzi and Happy here, this might just be a slaughter here. ESG trying to see if they can charge in. Uzi not really exposing himself too much. He goes down, Happy in the corner, takes the one kill, and then gets double teamed.
Not good enough from Happy there, but this may set up for a Maniac who's going to rush in, deny the plant, but he takes too long as well.
Oh no, Kaylee.
Now it's just Kaylee.
Oh, the lag. Oh, that's just very unfortunate. That's not a way you want to see a team lose a round. Not saying that LDLC would have won the round if he had been here, but obviously that left them in a really bad position. So that happens in the middle of the round, Kaylee up to over 100 ping and just kind of AFK and spawn. That's not really fun.
That's,
yeah,
That's unfortunate, because maybe he makes the difference looking up with that AWP towards B doors.
Yeah, anything could have happened, right?
Don't do the knife kill. Oh, wait then, don't do the knife kill.
I was gonna say, that is a big difference, because the knife kill is $1,500, so we'll see. They might, I don't know, it actually, well, no, that timeout must have happened at least 90 seconds into the future, so it probably was the next round anyway, before they really knew he was timed out, but obviously seeing him there, they could have guessed, so we'll see what the decision is. A little bit unfortunate here. 2-3 is the scoreline, and we are waiting, obviously, for some sort of verdict on what's happening to Kaylee.
Did he drop the AWP for Delpan as well?
Yes, I think he must have.
He dropped... They're saying that he dropped his AK, but I thought that he picked up Delpan's AWP. Does that make a difference, though? I mean, he is picking up an AWP for Delpan.
I think the reason why I can't see chat right now, I think it's because I have the seal of hide server IP on. So I think that also removes the chat to make sure that nobody can... At least I haven't turned the chat off otherwise, so I'm thinking that's the reason.
He dropped his AK. He dropped an AK. I wish we could go back real quick and check just to make sure, but I think he did actually pick up that AWP as well to save and bring it over to Delpan. Regardless...
Well, that's never
100 bucks that Hoiten shouldn't have had. Like, he should have got 300 there.
Exactly. And that is, in the grand scheme of things, a pretty big deal, because it means, obviously, that, you know, because you look at ESG's economy, it's not looking good. Delpan has a little bit, but that's because he was just given an AWP as well. Everyone else is fat broke, so it does make a big difference.
At that point, I don't know. At that point, Hoiten should have just left Kaylee. Well, do you leave a guy with an AWP? I mean, you are going to go hunt him.
Yeah, I mean, if you just killed him normally, it would be like a different thing. I think the knife makes it a little bit different, but we're going to leave that, I think, to the admins to decide what will be happening here. Obviously, a little bit of a shame for LDLC coming off of two really good round wins, and then losing a round like that, it's got to be painful. I mean, you don't want to give your enemies a way back into the game. But it's been close so far. I think it's really hard to predict. I just think the fact that LDLC are on the CT side and they had this kind of start is a pretty good sign for them.
Pardon me, that LDLC or that ESG?
LDLC, I think they had a pretty good start overall.
They've had the two rounds. They have reasonable money. I still feel like this could go anyway. Like this should be a round of eco out of LDLC, so ESG are going to have a little bit of a buffer to play with. Yeah. And then, it's going to come down to the eighth round, the seventh round, rather. That's pretty much going to be the big deciding factor here.
It does feel like it. Quick shout out and thanks to Navida for subscribing, and also anyone else that we've missed. Normally, we don't get a chance to call out people who subscribe, because we just can't do it in the middle of a game. That would be weird. But thanks to all of you again. It really makes a big difference for us to have subscribers. Helps us run the channel and keep everything active. And thanks to everyone else for following the channel. We broke 130,000 followers tonight, which is a pretty big deal for us. Last time I checked, we were a number 93 on the Twitch ladder, so 93 overall followers on all streams, which is pretty cool, I think. But obviously we want to raise the flag for Counter-Strike even higher, and you guys can help us do that. Also, you can go and follow us on Twitter, and also check out the links at the bottom of the stream for not just our sponsors Facebook, where you can go and participate in a raffle that's coming up this Wednesday, but also for our YouTube channel, where you can go and watch VODs, including these ones. If you're joining us late, you will be able to watch them on YouTube. Actually, we've been pretty much on point with doing it the day after, so it's not a long delay anymore before they come up on YouTube. That's what it is. What else to say? How's the
Apparently
international FXO going?
FXO wants a hug at the next LAN. So they're talking about FXO being on the new Epsilon lineup.
Yeah, now we wish we had Vendetta here so he could give us some wisdom and everything. But I have a feeling Vendetta is either with some family or he's been swallowed by the international, which I don't blame him for. I told Vendetta earlier today that if you wanted to join, he was always welcome. We always love having him. But if you wanted to watch the international, then I would not hold it against him, because he's been watching a lot of Dota and enjoying it. So
I think everybody is at this point. If you have two monitors and the internet to handle it, you've probably got CS and the international going at the same time.
Right. Yeah.
Everybody's going to be watching this tournament. It's $10 million. That's a lot of money. $5 million to first place now. That's insane.
Yeah, and maybe if you believe, just like in the Disney movies, if you believe, maybe a peek into the future of what could be in store for Counter-Strike, if you really trust in it. Valve have already been dropping hints about a potential for creating an international type event for Counter-Strike. So, yeah, and I've been stating this for a long time. I think Counter-Strike is a game that could really support it as well. So we'll see. I think Kaylee's back on the server with a ping that is much more reasonable, and now we're just going to resume the game. So welcome to the stream, everyone. Enjoy your stay, and we are going to be resuming here with the sixth round between ESG and LDLC.
And this is it. Now we get to see. I mean, LDLC, they are going to be egoing this round. Their money is too random at this point for them to be doing anything with it. You have a couple members who could buy, and then a couple members who absolutely have to eco. So Uzi with a good nade, actually tagging up Roken. But then both with this CZ75, he could get a kill. Not going to get it, though. Just barely failing.
Yeah, if they push up now, it's a little bit of a tricky issue, because Krithin is down here on the staircase just waiting. But Happy goes down. Some good damage onto Roken. Krithin, you are right. That's not bad.
Let's see exactly. I mean, right now, there we go. Uzi gets rewarded, manages to find Hoiten. That's going to be an AK for him to use as well. So he's going to be pretty pleased with that, although he is only floating around 50 HP. Good shot from Delpandad mid, down mid, picks off Maniac. And this should go.
Well, I'm not so sure. Right now, they're looking so jumpy, ESG. They're really, really taking a long time, and they look like they're actually scared of LDLC, which you can never, ever play a game of Counter-Strike and be scared of your opponent. That just doesn't work. You got to just assume that you are the best and that you're going to be winning. Otherwise, it's so hard to play. Apex takes down another one, and this is a 2-on-3, and it's definitely not over. Apex has full HP. He's going to be coming up in the middle spots. One, and Delpan ducks just at the right time. Oh, God. I think that was a little bit lucky from Delpan. He didn't see Apex when he ducked the first time. A good job from Delpan taking down those three players, but that could have been a 1-on-2, and then who knows?
Then who knows what happens, because Uzi's got the CZ. He's up close. I think he headshot Michaelele as well. Caught the edge of the cliff there, so... Or of the... caught the edge of the ledge, huh? But that is still very good work from LDLC out of an eco round, managing to do that much damage to ESG. That's what they need to be doing right now, LDLC. They can't let ESG run away with the money. They have to keep the pressure up on LDLC, keep getting kills, so that when LDLC do win a round, ESG, either they eco or they don't put much of a buy together, but you know, they have to put them down fast.
And a great tower in the middle here, Apex and Uzi. And the great thing about it is that Uzi's looking into the wall. Oh no, he's going to turn around and he goes down. Michaelele with a great pick off. I was going to say, the cool thing about that setup is that Apex is watching, but if a flash comes through, then Uzi will at least not be flashed. Unfortunately, they didn't count on Michaelele being there, and now they're in a pretty bad position.
This is where it kind of falls apart. Happy's going to push into upper dark. Not sure if he spotted Rogue. He will. Gets the spray. Gets a kill. But in the meantime, ESG are looking towards this A site, and there's two guys here to defend, but no AWP. It's going to be down to Maniac and Kaylee. There is a Molly on Kaylee, so he could delay the plant if he wanted to, if he could manage to land that nade right.
Yeah, but this is tricky, and he's being backstabbed as well. They got to coordinate this so well, and they've proven in the past LDLC that they can, in fact, do that, so we'll see. 28 seconds here. They got to make a move, ESG. They don't want to run out of time, and it sounds like they are right now. Time to step up and commit to this bomb site. Maniac in the corner is going to go down, and there's the committal, but actually much later than I would have liked. If Kaylee or Maniac had got a good kill on someone there from ESG, that round could have been way too close. And again, I say again, I think ESG aren't playing carefully right now. It seems to me like they're playing scared, and I'm not liking it.
Playing scared. They are managing to make it work in the end, just barely this time. LDLC not quite able to land the shots, despite Happy coming back and picking off Roke. That's just not enough. Like, Hoiten living with 5 HP, Delpan with half, Michaelele with half. Like, those are situations where LDLC needs to get those kills and just shut ESG down. But Happy holding onto a gun, that's actually fairly good here. They're not going to have enough to buy, but at least, you know, they do have a rifle to fall back on this next round. The real thing that concerns me at this point, ESG, they shouldn't be playing scared, because they've got a pretty decent bank going up with Delpan now.
Yeah, Delpan can just drop for a couple of people and they should be alright. But this one rifle from Happy, I have a sense that it can definitely play a big factor. Just because LDLC have proven time and again that they're fine with just having pistols. Even that is enough for them to win rounds against ESG. So we'll see if it's going to make a big difference here. Kaylee pushing up takes a little bit of damage from a grenade that's been thrown by Emilio almost every round. So they should know that it's coming and he only takes about 8 damage. So it's not a big deal. Uzi the one hiding inside the B bomb site here, and ESG playing this time. This is what I would say the difference is between scared and careful. When you're doing this early in a round, I have no problem calling it careful play, and that's good. But when you do it when there's only 30 seconds left, I don't think it's careful. Unless you're Na'Vi, you're not being careful. You're probably just a little bit scared of what's happening.
Yeah, because Na'Vi will actually, that's all part of the strategy. It's all about making your opponent sweat. You know, ESG could be doing the same thing right now. It's all about making LDLC sweat.
Only the Russian teams play like that. Like, Na'Vi and Hellraisers will give in. Swedish teams, generally not. But maybe it is. I mean, if we keep seeing it consistently, okay, we can call it a style. We are down to 40 seconds here. And I don't mean consistently in this game, I mean, you know, consistently in the next couple of months. Uzi's waiting behind the box here up on the plateau, and he's going to be the only one as well, which is unfortunate. CSET 75 in hand, but actually still picks up the kill and has time to reload, and now time for his teammates to come in. He does go down, so, you know, good stuff. Now Kaylee going to be peeking in, and someone should be watching the window, but weirdly, nobody actually was.
Yeah, that's another thing about communication and making sure that you're actually watching everything, because everybody from ESG, they were watching towards doors, right? They didn't look towards where Kaylee was hiding on plateau, or not Kaylee, Uzi. So that was definitely a mistake from ESG. This is them just kind of tunnel visioning, and that can't be a mistake that they can't allow themselves to make that kind of mistake.
No, I mean, that was almost a retake from LDLC being 4-on-4 and having no guns except the one that was on Happy or Maniac. So again, I don't know, the Frenchmen, I feel like they could have had so many more rounds right now, and I don't know if it's down to the Kaylee's disconnect or whatever it is, but right now 6-2 feels like it's much closer than that between the two teams, which means, I mean, because we're only 9 rounds in, it could turn around. LDLC could still have a great half here.
They can, they definitely can. With a round like this, that's going to be setting it up for them here with the rifles, the nades. They have everything they need. This is the big opportunity that LDLC have been waiting for. While their money has been so sketchy, so you know, all over the place, at least now they have enough to be able to put a reasonable buy together. They just have to come through and pick up the entry. I think that's what they're looking for here, because we will see ESG freeze up if they do. If LDLC manage to get the early advantage here, ESG might have real trouble coping with that.
Definitely. And Kaylee up here on the car looking towards short, and then smoke goes off. Actually, maybe saving Emilio there, because he was going to peek. He still does. Now they're charging in. Kaylee has to hit the shots here. They need to win this round. LDLC, this is pretty important. Apex, and there's Kaylee picking up the first kill. Nicely done. A second one to follow. He's going to go down, but oh, and Apex follows as well. This is not over yet. Emilio and Delpan are still alive and pushing up here. If they can catch Maniac, oh, and Emilio will. Now it's back into a 2-on-2, but the bomb has dropped down there, and maybe a little bit too much aggression here from LDLC. They gotta be careful they don't get picked up on Delpan. That would be senseless.
That is not supposed to happen. And I like the positioning here as well. They're rotating a man over to watch that bomb, because now they've realized exactly what's happening here. Delpan is gonna have to go jumping down or just look for the kills. I mean, right now he's looking towards short, hoping to catch somebody off guard, but LDLC, they're not concerned by this. They're willing to just sit and listen, because they will hear him go for that bomb. And there you go. Opportunity by Happy, and he takes it, catches Delpan out in the middle of nowhere. I have no idea why the bomb carrier for ESG thought it would be a good idea to jump up on short like that and just stand there and be an easy target for Kaylee to just drop the bomb down onto CT slope like that.
Definitely mistake. Definitely very lucky that Happy survived that AWP shot from Delpan. That was not that he would have won the round if Happy had gone down, but a little bit unfortunate there for Delpan. I think there were a lot of weird mistakes that round, and the bomb definitely being one of them. I think LDLC almost made a horrible mistake pushing up on short when they were in that 2-on-2. Because there was no bomb plan yet, they didn't really have to force that issue. And if Emilio had got a kill or Delpan just had hit the off shot, then they could have lost the round for no reason at all. But it was good to see them readjust as soon as they realized what was happening. That's a really healthy sign, I think, for LDLC that they can readjust to those kinds of awkward situations. And now they win another round. 6-3 here, and another disconnect coming in from Kaylee.
Kaylee, I wonder what's going on with him at this point. Nobody is online, obviously, to check, although what we can do is this.
Well, we'll figure it out in a second. In the meantime, just to update you guys on the standings here for SLTV in this in the group here, we have actually got, let me see, I think it was Hellraisers. Yeah, Hellraisers on top right now with 8 wins, 1 loss, and 1 draw. Mouse Sports in second place, actually, with 6 wins, and then ESG, Fnatic, VODS Pro, and LDLC, Navi, and then it sort of, you know, trails down from there. That's what we're looking at. Epsilon and Titan both just with 1 win each, but I guess they haven't played as much as the others yet, so they have some time to catch up yet, but those are the standings at the moment. Again, thank you for joining us here at Room on Fire. I hope you guys are going to enjoy your stay and have been enjoying your stay this evening. 25,000 people tuning in on the night where we have just best of one games and also the internationals going on. I think that's a pretty big win, so thank you guys for doing that, and I hope you guys will follow the channel and also subscribe to us. It definitely helps us out. Yeah, and also on Twitter as well. Why not, when you're at it, if you don't already have a Twitter account, then you can go and do that. And just because we sometimes like to, at least I sometimes like doing this, if you want to give a big welcome to, let's see, I'm going to find the link so you guys don't have to. Maxaki, who just came back into the game and said he's going to spend the next 6 months playing professionally and trying to see if he can really make a life out of playing Counter-Strike. This is his Twitter, so if you want to give him a welcome, you can just go and follow his account. He's got 125 right now, and I bet he'd be excited if he came back and saw that there were more people joining. He's a pretty good player, why not? I think it's always fun when someone decides that they want to go all in on the esports project. It is not an easy choice to make, I assume.
Kaylee is going to hotspot his iPhone.
Okay. That can, I've played Counter-Strike from my Android phone, so it's possible, but probably not ideal.
That's definitely not... that makes me think of when Forrest tried to play on his 4G dongle. You remember that?
Well, I hope it's 4G and not 3G he's playing from. Otherwise, there's really no saving him.
It's France. It's 3G. It's probably 2G in
you
France.
Can't, you can't. You just can't play from 3G. That's just... That would be suicide. If he comes in and has a ping that's less than 50, it's definitely 4G. And it's not even about the ping. It's the round trip time that's horrible for 3G. All right. Hopefully that's not going to be an issue. We're still waiting on an update again, and we are sorry about the delay. Of course, Kaylee having some internet issues, or some internet issues are being done to him. Nobody really knows at this point, but hopefully it will disappear and we can get back to a normal game here. Yeah. So again, more advertising. If you guys want to participate in the raffle that we'll be doing on Wednesday for our Case King of the Hill tournament cooled by Alpenfoon, then you can go and click the Facebook link at the bottom of the stream page here. And also you can check out our newly created YouTube account that has all the VODs that we've been doing so far, including last week's Case King of the Hill, where it was Navi who ended up winning. This week we're going to have Epsilon and Hellraisers played out against Navi, so that's going to be an incredible amount of fun. The people, well, I mean, Epsilon, well, shall we say Shoxy? Shoxylon? Beat Hellraisers at Dream. No, you say no.
You're not supposed to put that out there yet, Anders.
It's already. I think someone said Case King had already announced it. Either way, we're announcing it anyway, so guys will know. Oh, is that Sean Gares subscribing? Really, Sean? As if though I could love you any more than I already do. Thank you very much, Sean.
It's not possible to love Sean anymore. It's like absolute. Like, he can do whatever he wants. The love will not go higher or lower because it's already impossible to love him more, right?
That's true.
Bam. That's what's happening with the Gares.
Stuck at the ceiling, just always at maximum love. Appreciate
Sean
that.
Needs to get back over to Europe. Been too long. You need to get back over to Europe, Sean. Come on, man.
I Buy Power already going to be joining us here in Europe, I think, on the 31st of this month. So they're going to be, at the end of the month, they're going to be joining us. And they'll obviously be boot camping for G3 and Gamescom. And I've already asked them if they want to be in the Case King tournament. And they've expressed some willingness. So if with a little bit of luck, that's going to happen. And that could be fun.
Apparently, yes. It was a mistake that was made, but it has been announced for tomorrow already. So the teams that we were going to have for this Wednesday's tournament, you guys know now. Epsilon and Hellraisers will be the challengers, and Na'Vi are the kings waiting in the finals. But that's going to be sick. I cannot wait to see who's going to come out on top and actually go up against Na'Vi. There's a lot in that match that's going to happen.
Especially with Mistu being removed and FXO being put on the team.
True.
Yeah. So we'll see, looking to see if he's going to be picking up an AWP, maybe. That could be a lot of fun. We'll see, guys. The freeze time has been cancelled, and now we're ready here. 10th round coming up. Still the first half of this game. A little bit disjointed because of the disconnects, but we'll see. Kaylee is back, and his ping is really good. 31, so I'm guessing it's a 4G network that he's on. Otherwise, it's not going to work, and that is actually playable. You can do that if you have a pretty good connection for it. Emilio peeking out is going to take a quick grenade, and he's down to 53. So a good start for LDLC, and now Uzi's going to be pushing up pretty aggressively. Rogue is ready and waiting. He should be able to pick up the kill, and he will. So those kills are really important. The easy ones like that, you should be able to. Kaylee flashes himself out on long and goes down, and that's maybe a little bit too much.
That's definitely a bit too much. I mean, I understand when you're a man down, but sneak, don't flash, I guess. I mean, if he's lucky with the flash, he catches him and he gets two free kills, but there's also the opportunity to just look through. ESG, though, they're not really leaving anything to chance. And you gotta, that's something that we need to be seeing from the from this quality, this level of team. They need to be covering all of the points so that when LDLC are man down, they don't have the opportunity to come back and poke for information and get freebie kills. ESG, they just shut it down before it even gets rolling, before LDLC even have a way to get back into this game, because right now, LDLC are down three men. Happy does manage to pick up one, but Emilio catches Maniac on the rotation, and now ESG, all they have to do is go A.
Oh, that's such a shame. It looked like they were actually going to be rushing into the middle and just, you know, flooding towards where Happy was, and that could have been a pretty cool sequence, but you're right, it was that made it a big difference. They just instantly rotated towards the A-bomb side, and then they even picked up Happy in the middle once he started to rotate over. That's now no money for LDLC and a 7-3 lead for ESG, and things are looking pretty good right now for the Swedish team.
The Swedish team are going double AWP versus an eco round as well. I don't know if I like that. It's a bit risky. If LDLC were to rush down one of the oppers or figure out where Delpan is, I mean, obviously, LDLC probably not going to be expecting ESG to have the two ops. So they're probably not going to try and do anything concentrated to pick him off like this. But still, like, ESG, what is with terrorist teams tonight going double op all the time on Dust 2?
I really don't know. It's just apparently, you know, become a popular thing. Kaylee pushing out here. Oh, actually, it's going to be Delpan with the kill in the middle, but he's looking for the 1D, and Emilio is his target of choice. He's not going to get it. Takes a lot of damage through the door, and even though they try and double-team him, he is actually going to go down eventually. I thought he could pick up both those kills. Seemed like he was in a good position, but the bomb is in the middle, and actually, they're going for the B-bomb side, even though Delpan is out hunting alone. Again, for some weird reason.
That's just Delpan, I guess.
I don't know. No, nobody else does this. It's a crazy idea. What if you go down? What if you somebody's hiding somewhere and you're not, you know, spotting them? Then you just give them an AWP to the enemy team, to Kaylee. Why would you do it, Delpan? Why?
I don't know. I think it's kind of like the... Oh, hold on. No, nothing. It's kind of like the get right, the JW, you know, just like go off, do your own thing, bro, and then we'll figure it out afterwards. But Delpan just does it, just takes it a step further, and really just goes out there. Rogue just got ridiculously lucky and catches Happy to the head through the smoke. So nothing is working for LDLC this round, or this half. Like, nothing is going their way.
It feels like they've run out of steam a little bit, which is unfortunate, though. A good return kill coming out from Uzi. This is what they need. Let's see if LDLC can be back on their feet after a pretty unfortunate start here. Mike Lillio in the middle is going to take down another kill. And ESG really are committed. I mean, I'm noticing this now. They really are committed to this very slow style, just walking around picking people off, which is, as I said earlier, more commonly identified with teams like Na'Vi or Hellraisers. So it's interesting seeing a Swedish team picking it up, but it seems to be working decently for them at least. And in the middle, Krypton taking the fight here with Kaylee and comes out short. Kaylee does. Now it's going to be Uzi in a 1-on-3, and this is going to be a 9th round for ESG unless Uzi can somehow just one-man this, but he can't. Delpan is going to call the timeout for him, and it's going to be into the 13th round with no money against Semler. This match has not turned out the way I expect it.
No, and what really hurts LDLC is because they don't have the money, they don't have the confidence to play their... It almost feels like to play their game. Like, we haven't seen anything crazy out of Akali, we haven't seen anything crazy out of Apex. None of them have really gone for, like, aggressive pushes or trying to catch ESG off guard anywhere. It really is, you know, bread and butter, like, vanilla play coming out from LDLC. This round, however, it does work with those CZs, but... they do manage to bring it back to a 3-on-3 here, ESG. Although, as I say that, Uzi and Happy push into Upper Dark and catch Rogue off guard.
Yeah, and Rogue was pushing them as well for some strange reason, so pretty interesting stuff. Delpan takes down Uzi with a great angle, but he might get caught by Apex, who's close with the CZ 75. This round is not over, and I mean, this is the kind of spark that I was talking about that I saw earlier in LDLC. Just even with pistols, they are really terrifying teams. I'm strange that they haven't been able to pick it up when they have rifles, but we'll see. Apex, oh my god, what a great headshot. Takes down Delpan, and he's going to be remembering that for a couple of days. Now it's on Hütten here, 1-on-2.
Yeah, but both players for LDLC have such low health. They can do this, though. The AWP from Happy, if he can just find the shot, he's going to be coming up on short right now. The smoke is down to block it, and look at Hütten. He spots out Apex, gets the kill, but then Happy pushes through the smoke and finds him standing on the box. No time for Hütten to get out of the way, get hidden. LDLC just did not give him the opportunity.
Very nicely done, and you know, in spite of the smoke, I mean, that's the really big thing. It could have been that Happy would have been waiting on the other side, but he was there and ready in position, so great round coming out. 9-4 here, and finally something goes right for the French. They even saved the AWP, of course, and ESG still have a lot of money, and even if they lose this upcoming round, they're probably still going to have enough money to buy. That's the downside, but at least there is an opening now for LDLC to get a reasonable first half. I think if they can get to 5 rounds, they are going to be okay here.
If they can get to 5 rounds, yeah. If they can get 6, that would be stellar. But that means, I mean, obviously they have to win this round right here. They have to win this round right here as well, LDLC, because if they lose it, again, they're going to be back to basically forcing up with pistols and armor and a couple nades. They just don't have money in the bank. So again, LDLC, all of the pressure is on them to save their half at this point. Recover from all from the pauses and just get the job done here now.
That is exactly right. And I think it's possible. Apex jumps down just at the wrong time, and now Michael Ely is peeking up there, but he still goes down. Really good peek from Apex. Takes down the first player. They're still committed to this B push, and Uzi's right here on the corner. He's not going to be flashing in. Gets flashed by a teammate, but it's not enough. He goes down eventually. Apex trying to put some shots through. It's really happy inside this bomb site. That's the main play. He tries for that flashbang again. Rogue peeks out and takes him down, and now it's a 3-on-3 retake. This time, Happy's flashbang didn't work as well as it did against the Danish team.
And this is no good because Delpan is holding at mid. He catches Apex, and now LDLC, they're going to be giving up valuable seconds now, having to worry about Delpan camping them out with that AWP. And you know, we talked about Delpan. He is perfectly comfortable in those sorts of situations up close with that sniper rifle. It's not a problem for him. So LDLC, they clear it out on B slope, but now they're down a man for a B site retake. This is going to be so very difficult for them.
Yeah, almost impossible, right? Easy kill coming in there, and now Kaylee with the AWP. They should chase him down, and he will go down. Running shot from Hütten, and a triple kill here for the top fragger on ESG together with Delpan. 15-15 for each, and we're looking at a 10-4 scoreline where LDLC don't really have much for the final round of this half. Kaylee has an AWP and Apex, oh sorry, Uzi has a FAMAS, and who knows, that could be enough.
That could be enough. I mean, hell, they just won an anti-eco. I mean, yeah. With pistols, it seems like a lot of players are doing better with pistols than they are on rifle rounds. It's weird, makes a weird kind of sense, I don't know. But a great nade, hello! Mike Lilly catches Uzi before he can land, but that was about to do massive damage.
It's almost like he shot the grenade midair, kind of like you could do an Unreal with that weird plasma weapon, you know? If you could do that in this game and have that be a strategy, it'd take some skill, I'd say, shooting grenades midair.
I mean, hell, is Delpan good enough? Is Michaelele good enough? I'd say so.
Could think be. Maybe like shooting a Molotov midair and just having it, you know, burn, you know, in a particular
spot.
Have
you ever had like a nade like bump into each other, like two nades bump into each other?
I've only seen videos on that on the Global Offensive subreddit. I've never tried it.
It's happened to me a couple times. HE nades too. I was very sad. But like, it's just astronomical odds. You're just like, how? Maybe shooting a nade, same thing.
Why, Gaben? Why you do this? Kaylee does actually get the flick shot on and does a good amount of damage to Delpan, but doesn't get the kill. Now the push is going to be on for the B bomb site, and they're going to be leaving Emilio behind here. If he gets a backstab in the middle, assuming they even get into the B bomb site, it could be really good. Happy with the pistol, going to be charging out here. He goes down now. Apex inside, just a C set 75, and they are putting the weak man first, but he doesn't even go down. Kaylee misses the shot, and this is not looking good for LDLC. Maniac going to be alone. And not really a chance here. Rushing through the smoke, gonna take a quick kill, and that will not be enough here. 11-4 for the first half in favor of ESG.
And that's the scary bit here is that now ESG switch over to the CT side, and ESG are very good on the CT side. That double op comes into play as soon as they manage to get the money for it. I mean, we saw them start. USSR got 3 rounds at the beginning, but then ESG just ran away with the game. they just shut down the remainder of the half, and it wasn't even really a second half. USSR got stomped. So now it comes down to whether LDLC can stop that. They've got four rounds, Anders. I don't know if that's enough versus ESG.
I don't know. I don't want to count LDLC out. I really think they've shown some good promise tonight, but the pistol round is going to be of all importance. And then you're right, even after the pistol round, it is hard to come back. But if they win the pistol round and make it, you know, 7-11 and then also win the fourth round, then they're within, you know, then we're looking at 9-11 and then it's within striking distance. So it's definitely possible, sure. But there's a lot of stuff that has to work out here for the French team, and maybe it will. Welcome to the show, everyone. If you're just joining us, then thanks for tuning in. This is Room on Fire, and we have the SLTV Style Series Season 10 match between LDLC and ESG. Best of one game, and it's in the second half, so a good time for you to join me. And we do have one more game coming up after this one.
And that's true. We do have one more, but right now this game, I mean, it's all on this pistol. This is LDLC. They have to play it perfectly. They had two guys go full nades as well. Double flash and smokes. So this is interesting. It makes me wonder exactly where they want to take this, and it's going to be a B split, but look at what the play is here for ESG. They're pushing into upper dark, both members as well. Maniac spots this, and the rest of LDLC are closing in behind. ESG are about to get sandwiched in. They have to go.
Yep, and they just hesitate for far too long, and that just gives the gun round to LDLC. Very cool stuff coming out. That was a really nice push from the French team. They definitely deserve that, and up on short here as well, it's going to be Happy going down, but it doesn't even matter at this point. They can't really do anything to retake this, and I actually don't even mind if they save like the Molotov, the armor, and the fuse kit they have here, because I think pushing in so late is going to be almost impossible.
I mean, they just have to put those USPS to work, but Apex has got one too. He gets two kills for his trouble, goes leaping over the flames, a Michael Bay finish, and that's LDLC picking up the pistol round. I mean, that needed to happen, right, Anders? Like, you just said it right there. If they can pick up the pistol round, if they can pick up the 19th round, LDLC are right back in this match. Now, so that's a big boost for them.
Did you see who was it on the Terry side that was holding up a dark? I really forget. Was it Maniac?
It was Maniac, yeah. Yeah. And it was Broken Delpan who pushed in.
So if they push and kill Maniac, then the push is all of a sudden very, very different. Actually, that would be a huge benefit to ESG, because they would have the rest of LDLC boxed in. Sure, they'd give the bombsite away, but they would have a 5-on-4 retake. So it's very, very good that Maniac stayed alive and that ESG just hesitated a little bit too long.
Was it Uzi? I think it was Uzi with Maniac in Upper Dark as well that did a lot of the work.
Yeah.
What's interesting here is, look at this. ESG go for a full stack on A. They only buy a flash.
They stack CT spawn.
But they don't spend anything. Look, USPS across the board.
This is true. Flashbang on Michael Lillie. Actually, this is just... Yeah, so they just want to flash out and peek long all at the same time. It's a very, very cool idea. If they had hit the timing, which obviously they didn't, which means they should be slaughtered, but they're doing a lot of damage, way more than they should here. Happy battling it out. Might be able to take down Delpan, and he will. So good adjustment from Happy. They sealed the round, but... that's how much damage they did when they got the timing completely wrong. Imagine how good the damage would have been if LDLC had been pushed up to the middle along.
They don't.
What? Sorry.
Sorry, no, I'm looking. I'm just looking to see if they were going to go for a buy, because they just did a lot of damage to LDLC.
No.
They didn't spend any money in the last round. I was curious to see if ESG... I mean, I would have been very surprised if they did go for it.
I wouldn't have been surprised. I would have been really angry if they had tried that. But I'm glad that they're buying flashbangs here. I mean, when you have, as we said earlier, Delpan and Michael Lillie, and you have this kind of lead, you got to bank on the double up setup being the way to close out the game, basically. But these flashbangs are still important, except Delpan throwing one, and then, I don't know, that's just weird. They should just use them like they did before, basically. It's a very cool idea.
Well, all is five. I mean, it worked really well. If they can have the same kind of results here in this half, that'd be fantastic. Rogue spots Happy getting to pit, though. And now Happy's going to be able to start putting a little bit of pressure here, maybe stopping that play from even happening. Hoiten still has one flash to work with. And there are four members here for ESG on the A site. But Delpan getting caught on B isn't going to help things now. LDLC know that that site is open. They can sneak their way out.
Yeah, so smart decision making from LDLC, just slowly making sure they don't throw anything away. And I actually think that's been one of the strengths of the French team here in the past, is they've been really good at not throwing away anti-eco rounds. So that is a good start here. Uzi is going to go down eventually and does give up an AK. They're going to try, if they can run away with this, that's a really big win for ESG.
I almost want to see him make them spend money, though. There you go. Rogue gets one kill onto Apex. He's still alive as well. Happy's really trying to get rid of them, and there's the spray! Emilio wants that AK so bad, and it's going to cost him. But he gets a kill! ESG coming out ahead somehow in the spray fight. This is big for ESG. They've just made LDLC spend so much money.
Yes, they have. Maniac and Kaylee trying to guess the right way out of the bomb site to not run into these crazy Swedish people. And they are going to guess it running down towards CT spawn, but that turned it from a really good round, and I was just praising LDLC for being so good at playing these rounds, and now, instead, they gave away 3 kills and 2 AKs going into a round where ESG were going to be buying anyway, so, I mean, definitely going to be a double-up setup, I think, this time.
Yeah, Delpan's got more than enough right now to get AWP armor, so we have to see. Michaelele going for the rifle, though.
Oh, just the one, all right.
Just the one. Emilio can buy an AWP again next round, though, regardless of what happens here, so ESG, it's their time to shine. What do they have in store for us here? And LDLC, look at LDLC, how passively they've played this. Hanging all the way back at the top of mid, at the top of mid towards A long there. Really just taking their time, expecting ESG maybe to go for some aggression.
But I think that's really good play. I like the fact that they do that. Don't want to... This is the one round where you really can't afford to get caught off in any weird way. Now they're going to be pushing out, and Delpan goes down. A great start here. Kaylee with a running headshot. Rogue is down, and the rest of ESG have to just run away. There's no reason for them to throw away any more rifles here. Good shot from Michaelele through the smoke, but it doesn't really matter. They just got to stay alive. Happy jumps down from short to take down Michaelele, and it's going to be just the lone guy left here. Top of mid with an M4A1.
Yeah, going from a fantastic 2 eco rounds to this round here, Delpan getting caught. Not sure if Delpan was flashed, but that was brutal that he actually stayed in window and just went down like that, missing a crucial shot. But then Roke as well. Like, Roke wasn't even able to buy any time for his teammates to rotate in or anything. He was flashed, didn't even see it, got killed, and then LDLC, they couldn't have had an easier B take.
Well, and not going to be saving that one either, so a little bit unfortunate. There's still a lot of money on ESG because they got to save those 2 AKs, so I wouldn't be surprised if they're going to buy here anyway, just because it'll be just one guy, Delpan, basically, without too much, and probably someone's going to buy for him. So, and they don't want to let LDLC back into this game, which they definitely are. At this point, it's anybody's game. 8-11 is a perfectly fine score for LDLC to make a comeback with. It wouldn't even be like a monumentous comeback.
No, Delpan, Roke taking a lot of damage to start, though. And Apex, look at how aggressive he's playing this. Delpan and Roke. Roke got tagged. Apex finds him immediately. Now it's going to come down to Delpan. He doesn't have Kevlar. He needs to time this perfectly, and it's not going to happen. Again, Apex with the entries gets B site for his team.
And that looked like really sloppy play from Delpan. Like, what? Did you see what he was doing then?
He was just hiding.
No, I mean, he was pre-aiming the corner where Apex ran out, and Apex wasn't even looking the right way. Apex was looking the wrong way compared to where Delpan was, and he still did almost no damage to him. That looked like Delpan like had his hand off the mouse, which obviously he didn't because he knew that they were coming, but it just looked so strange.
Yeah, that's not... Well, at least there is something here. Emilio finds one, but Apex isn't done yet. He's rotated into CT spawn now. He's still on the hunt. Huiten just barely gets into pit in time to save himself here. But it's not over. Apex, he's relentless. They're just getting closer. They're closing in on Huiten.
Yeah, and LDLC doing the right thing here. Trying to take all the rifles away, basically, from the Swedish team. If they can, they do lose a couple here, but it's still worth it. This is really good play coming out from the Frenchmen. They're doing what they should be doing and trying to just invest that into it. I don't mind if Kaylee runs away because the AWP is a slightly more expensive weapon, but it would have been worth it if they could have got these rifles. And even look at the money they have on LDLC side. They can give up a couple of rifles to try and steal something away.
They can do a whole lot here, actually. It's a pity that Roke wasn't able to hold on to anything, but he's going to take the hit. Like, this is... Delpan is one of those offers, it seems, in ESG's eyes, that it's worth taking the hit for. Roke sacks his economy, gives him an AWP, and then just goes with a FAMAS and no Kevlar. So this is the importance now. All of the pressure is on Delpan to land a shot. Like, he needs to make this AWP count for his team right now.
Yep, right now they just need a lot of rounds here in a row. ESG, they need to reestablish control of the game. Otherwise, it's not going to be working out too well. LDLC are definitely fired back up again to where they were at the beginning of this game. So we'll see if it's going to carry all the way through. 11-9 is the score right now. Still 2-round lead for ESG, but that can get closed out very quickly. In fact, one win here for LDLC, and it should be an eco for ESG, and then we've got a tight game on our hands.
Yeah, exactly. Then it's anybody's game at that point. But LDLC, I still think LDLC are ahead, having closed this much this much of the distance between them after that first half. You know, 4 rounds. Now we lose Emilio for ESG. It just continues the pummeling that the Swedes are taking at this point. It's not letting up. Kaylee gets a second kill now onto Michaelele, keeping that aggressive position up on Cat, really making it work for him. It's down to Hoiten, who's stuck at long. He can't really go anywhere. And then the two guys on defense at B. Delpan gets a parting shot on Apex, but that's just not good enough.
No, those kills don't really count as much as they would have done earlier. At this point, and now, okay, so we saw on the Terror side how defensively or how passively ESG played it. They waited until there was, you know, 40, 20 seconds left on the clock, and then they went for the pushes. It feels like right now they're playing way too defensively on the CT side and basically just allowing themselves to get slowly picked off one at a time, and I'm not sure they're going to come out of this one with the rifles alive. Rogue up close here. Delpan does get a good shot in, but they're going to get overwhelmed, and LDLC this time are successful in taking away the rifles. And actually, ESG can still buy, because now they've lost six rounds in a row, so they have the money for it if they want to. It's not going to be a perfect buy, but they could do it if they want.
Well, FAMAS, armor, flash, or smoke, actually, if they wanted to. And there was some discussion there. Again, ESG, they don't actually go for it. They want to get another round of eco in so that Roke and Hoiten can full buy. Seems like that's the plan for them right now. But Apex, happy, they're just relentless. They're not giving ESG a chance here.
No, they're really not. Then trying to play a little bit of a game down here with Happy, who's already picked up the one kill. Smoke comes out as well. Pretty not going to make a big difference. Happy still, well, one bullet on him actually here should be enough. And there it is, body shot. So that works out. But these are really, really small victories for ESG. Nothing to write home about just yet.
Exactly. They're not going to have a big impact on the game as the way that things are going, because they have 13,000 bank right now on LDLC Kaylee. Happy has got 5-7 on Uzi. Like, the money is there for LDLC. They can afford to give up a couple members taking a round. That's not a problem for them at all. So ESG, they need more than this. They need these kills earlier, basically, so that they have time to do away with ESG to have an impact in the round.
Yeah, absolutely true. Critton, don't think he's going to be able to hold on to this AK. They're basically all charging him down, and he drops without taking anyone with him. So 11-11, LDLC have managed to equalize the score here, winning 7 rounds in a row in the second half, which is a very good job indeed. And now the double up setup comes out, but I still think this only really makes sense. I still want to see ESG just being a little bit more offensive and not just completely passive here.
Yeah, they need to go and, like, insult Apex's mother or something. I don't know. Bring that offense.
Yeah, but not in the middle like that. They did double peek, but because of Kaylee's position, only one of them was basically peeking against him. So that's a pretty good job. Uzi goes down the middle, but close here. Apex could take down Delpan. He goes for the spray. It's so close, and he's relentless. Gonna throw out a grenade as well, and Delpan does fall back to safety, but this is still a lot of pressure being put onto the middle, and he's ready for more. Almost drops the Swedish player, and now he's gonna fall back, but he's still done a hell of a lot in that position.
Well, one thing that LDLC have going for them right now is that they are going to actually manage to group up together. Not sure about about the call for long right now, though. ESG, they've still got three guys holding at long. I mean, this is big here. Big opportunity. Apex has to lead the charge, and he will. Huiten is flashed. There isn't a whole lot of health on Delpan. He gets one parting shot, but Apex with the headshot somehow. Emilio with the spray slows it down, and now we're into a 2-on-2, but there's still plenty of time here for LDLC.
There is, but they have to make this crossover. They can't even throw the bomb over. They do have the AWP on Kaylee. If Apex jumps and gets caught here, it's going to be a little bit awkward. He dashes to take the peek. Nobody's shooting at him, and Rogue has went away, maybe just at the wrong time, so that's unfortunate. Now Kaylee's going to peek against Emilio. He hears him as well. He does go down, but Apex is Apex, and he can still win this 1-on-2. They are close. He peeks out, tries to take down one. He will, turns around, and Emilio is there. Apex very nearly wins that. That is a triple kill here for the French captain, and a scary round for ESG, but at least they finally win one.
Yeah, from Delpan managing to pick up one. It really looked like the way that Apex was playing out from Longhouse like that, it just looked like he was going to steamroll through ESG. But yeah. Delpan picking up one, and then the rest of the team actually managing to turn it into a 2-on-2. That was just big plays there from ESG, and that's what they needed. I mean, now, you know, they let LDLC take 7 rounds in a row before finally coming up with an answer. And that answer is basically Emilio living by the skin of his teeth, because if he missed that headshot on Apex there with that USPS, he was dead. Apex was already facing him. So that's too close for comfort here.
Yeah, really, really scary stuff. And if Kaylee had been living a little bit longer, it would have also been a really frightening position for ESG. And obviously, here's where we say this all the time. Whenever someone's been on a losing streak and they finally win, the big thing is to keep winning. Split push coming out here. Michael Ilya in the corner. Flash comes in. He does get one. Very nearly drops two, but that's not enough. Rogue is still alone inside here, and he needs a lot of backup, and he needs it really quickly. But in the middle, they're just holding right now. They're not even going into the B-bomb site. They want that one more pickoff before they go for it, and Rogue will go down. Things are looking really good here for LDLC, and ESG just aren't equipped to handle this right now. Emilio even, I mean, jumping and shooting in upper dark, it just feels like the Swedes right now, I don't know, they don't have their heads in the game in the same way that LDLC do.
I managed to mute myself. Yeah, not right now. Not right now at all, in fact. I mean, despite the fact that ESG, they've won their first two games, it seems like LDLC, you know, that one win that they got has really fired them up. And this is definitely all going south now. ESG, their money, I mean, it's just wrecked. Emilio has enough to buy an op, but that's not going to be good enough when the rest of his teammates are floating around 1,500 bucks. And Delpan, or no, Kaylee, is already landing shots mid. At this point, it really just comes down to whether ESG can win the duels. Like, it doesn't really seem to be anything else. Like, they just need to be getting in the position to be able to pick up the early kills, but that's just not happening when Apex walks in everywhere and gets kills at will.
It also just feels like the way it's working out right now is that ESG is, they're holding so far back on the map that once the duel happens, it's basically almost in a bomb site to the point where if LDLC then do win the duel, all they have to do is basically walk up and plant the bomb, and ESG will be so far away and so far out of position that it's almost too late. Whereas if they were a little bit more aggressive and even just traded in the beginning, they'd still be in a better position than they currently are right now. They're just, I think the passive play is working quite heavily against them.
It's definitely not fitting to them either. I mean, they're a kind of team, I don't know, it feels like they're a kind of team that should be going for aggression as well. Like, that's why this game would be so, I mean, so crazy, is that LDLC, you know, they're known for having, like, Apex, Kaylee, you know, guys who like to take risks and get out in your face. And then ESG, you look at it and you've got, like, Michael Ilya and Delpan. Those are guys as well who are perfectly capable of, like, walking forward and kind of just, like, imposing their will, right? And Delpan is going to take a peek at mid-doors, and it's not going to really give him anything. So ESG, they're playing, I think, you know, what you said in the first half, you know, playing scared, that might actually have something to do with it here.
It still feels like it, and again, that's not a good place to play Counter-Strike from. We'll see this time a little bit more forward position from Hutton here. He's going to spot Kate, or actually just going to hear Happy through, and he's going to take the shot with the FAMAS. So that is finally a slightly better start coming out from ESG now. Let's see if they can actually hold on to it. That's a different matter altogether. The A bomb site seems to be what they're focusing on, though the bomb is in the middle, so they can change their minds quite quickly here, LDLC.
They can, as soon as they get a pick, really. And look at the position from short. They've snuck their way all the way out onto A site. Apex is just hoping, crossing his fingers, that somebody's waiting on this bomb site to peek up. That's not going to happen, though. The man is waiting in Goose. That's Roke right around the corner. Do they check? Apex looks around, gets caught. Emilio. Actually, it was Emilio in that position, and Emilio comes in big right now. LDLC finally gets shut down. Sick headshot from Uzi, though. And he gets two. Uzi opens it back up.
Yeah, he does, and no reason for Emilio or anyone else to peek in that position. That was a 5-on-2, now turned into a 2-on-3. The bomb is making its way up here. Uzi wants to see if he can put it down. They don't have any grenades on ESG to stop this, and now Rogue is walking in alone. Why on earth is this happening right now? There's no bomb plant. They're not under any pressure to do this. One grenade, and there could be another one to follow from Maniac, but he's going to jump down here. Rogue is now in a 2-on-2, and now a 1-on-1, and Krithin comes in from the right angle, but this is still, I mean, we see, I think, the gravity of the mistakes that ESG are making here. They only just make it out of that 5-on-2.
Just barely there. I mean, but that also comes down to just magnificent play from Uzi. His flick shot, I didn't spot who was jumping.
That's the first one. That was really good. But after that, they're in a 2-on-4, and there is absolutely no excuse for anyone to be doing anything in that position.
Yeah, Emilio shouldn't be peeking out and taking that fight at range, for example, you know. And it's also just like closing in, really just Uzi, three kills like that, making it happen for his team, landing the shots when ESG give him the opportunity to. At ESG now, they bring it back to 13-13. They get the round, you know, so despite the mistakes, they still pick up the round and they're still in this race. I mean, they do get a reasonable buy together. Delpan has an AWP to work with.
There's but three ops on the other
way
team.
To go before they can get LDLC to start ecoing.
They had three ops on the other team. Apex has dropped one in spawn, but actually I'm one. That's maybe a little bit too much money to invest into it here. 13-13. LDLC are not quite home free yet. They can't just buy all the rounds. If they lose two more in a row, then they won't really have enough money to buy. So they got to be a little bit careful. But I still like the double op setup. That's proven effective earlier. And this time Emilio is in the exact same spot. And I bet you they're going to check more this time.
Oh, Goose? Yeah, they will be. They'll do. It was a tough position to be in, really, for LDLC. They only had two guys. One of them had to watch long. The other guy had to watch Goose. Apex had to get that kill on Emilio, and he just didn't. So that's that was LDLC, you know, just relying on their ability to get the kills, and it just didn't pan out that way. Right now, LDLC, again, just relying on the picks. They're grouping up for an A split at this point, though. A man on cat, and now they're going to start working their way out long. Uzi, is he going to get the kill? Just barely lets Huiten get around the corner.
Yeah, but he's still trapped here. He can't really run back. Then he's going to get caught running. He just has to wait and try and take the duel. They do double team. The bomb is down here, and they're going to peek aggressively. Nice kill. Emilio, there's one more, and he's going to get the kill. And now, again, they're in a position that they basically can't lose unless they just horribly screw up here. Apex and Maniac have no time left to get the bomb and put it down. They are going to pick it up, and Apex is charging back. 8 seconds left, and now the game is pretty much up. If he can put it down, he's going to get his team some money, and that is probably the best case scenario. But winning this 1-on-4 should again... Well, actually, no, there's not even time. Wow.
Oh, Apex. You better live. And he does. Oh, that was scary. He didn't get the bomb plant, so he would have... I mean, he would have gotten zero bonus money for living through that round. I'm sure they're kind of kicking themselves for the misbuy of an extra AWP last round. That's a lot of money.
If they end up losing because of that, that would be truly painful, because you're absolutely right. That is a hell of a lot of money. And right now, they don't have any money at all. They have to win this upcoming round. Otherwise, ESG can actually take this game just based on the lack of economy. Kaylee's going to have money to buy, but he's the only one. So we'll see. This game is not over. LDLC, don't worry, guys. They can still come back and win this 16-13. It's definitely possible. But, oh, and especially with a shot like that, Kaylee opening up on Delphan.
Kaylee opening up on Delpan with an excellent headshot through the doors at mid. Delpan getting caught. Now Apex takes point again. Emilio gets spotted, but Roke manages to strike and pick up Maniac, who is trying to sneak his way into B site. So now LDLC, they realize, okay, there's defense there. We have to actually rotate back around. They're trying to take advantage of ESG having to rotate a man back out to mid to support B. So they're looking now for A. They're looking to see if they can't take advantage and get this kill here, because there's only one man holding. That's Michaelele with the AWP. He's holding it cross. But that's a terrific position for him to be in as well. Kaylee has to land the shot on Michaelele.
Look at the smoke that Happy threw down. That causes Emilio to rotate away. And actually, Emilio needs to be here. Walking out, he gets the shot, and that could have almost been a double. Kaylee is down, and now Michaelele can relax a little bit. Emilio coming in with a headshot as well. And this is not looking good for LDLC. They got to get this bomb down quick. And Uzi's on the task. That's really good. He's going to be planting it, not for short, though, where Happy is. So they got the bomb plant, but not the ideal one. They tried for it, though, but they don't really have a choice anymore. 2-on-4 retake, and Happy and Uzi, they have to keep this dream alive. Otherwise, LDLC are going to be in a really tough spot. Uzi close to the site. Happy's going to be walking right in, takes the first kill. Another one comes in. Happy goes down. Uzi still up here in a 1-on-2, takes another one. Now Michaelele, point-blank range with the USPS, tries to get it, and oh my god! That's a manly play. USPS to the face, and Uzi goes down, and ESG, they make their way to match and map point. 15-13, and there is actually enough money on LDLC's side to maybe just force this draw.
They can. They can do it. They have definitely enough money to get a good buy-in here. Much better than I thought they would, in fact. Kaylee, I knew, had quite a bit of bank, so I wasn't worried about his AWP, but for the rest of them, that bomb plant just saved LDLC, because the majority of them would have been on pistol armor and a couple of nades for LDLC. True. Had they not got that bomb plant. So that was big. That was really big for LDLC. But still, ESG, they've got all the rifles. They've got everything they need. Maniac gets a great headshot on Delpan. Delpan just not having any kind of luck this game.
That's the kind of duel you're really supposed to lose, especially against Delpan, right? You're peeking with an AK against a guy who's already scoped up towards you, and that was just, more manly plays coming out here, this time on Maniac's side. I love it. See if they can force their way to a 14th round. Michaelele in the middle. Bomb is dropped, and they take down another player. Good peek from Kaylee. Now Rogue alone has picked up an AWP, which is not the weapon we normally see him with. He's going to have to come up massive here. Picks off one in the bomb site, misses the shot, and that's going to be the last strikes he gets here. Huiten and Emilio, well, they don't have the money to actually go for this. They're going to have to wait and try and prevent the draw that LDLC is basically trying to force on them here.
Exactly. If they could have just gotten one more kill, maybe But now, yeah, they absolutely have to, because this is the money is just so tight for both of the teams. ESG, they just don't have enough for a real buy next round. So these two rifles are so important right now for the Swedes. But they aren't messing around. They get all the way over in Longhouse, and now they just sit and wait. And LDLC shouldn't be close enough to be able to pick them up here.
So no, now, and LDLC don't have a lot of money either.
The 30th round.
I mean, the Frenchmen don't have a lot of money either. If they go out over here and, you know, throw away three rifles, that can really come back to bite them as well. You know, so they've got to be a little bit careful, both teams. And that's why nobody's hunting as furiously as they were earlier. They'd love to pick someone off, but it's not going to happen. Here we go into the 30th round between LDLC and ESG. Again, thanks everyone for joining us, but this is what it's going to come down to. Either it's going to be a draw, there's no overtime in this league, or it's going to be a victory for ESG. Those are the only two options right now. Delpan picking up a scout. There's a Mag 7 on Mike Lilia. Signs of how poor ESG are at the moment.
Well, let's see. Rogue gets by unscathed, and so does Delpan. So at least the defense for B, they haven't managed to take any damage from Kaylee yet. No AWP for LDLC, though, so that may come back to bite them. Kaylee doesn't have that shot to put through. Uzi taking a lot of damage to start the top mid.
That's not Delpan
even sure
jumping.
How that happened.
Delpan jumping with the scout in the middle, got that kill. Now they're pushing into the Mag 7 here. Mike Lilia is there. He lets two people by. They need some backup quick. And Delpan is going to pick another kill, or actually another damage there. No kill happening yet. Mike Lilia is waiting right here. And in the corner, it's going to be Uzi. He does get the kill. And this looks like a draw. Emilio and Kritten left 2-on-4 right now. And things are looking not so good for ESG. It's going to be down to Kritten in a 1-on-4. And there's really no way he can do this. 15-15, and it is going to be a draw after all that action. Nobody gets to win. What a strange game this was.
That feels kind of fitting, though, because I don't think either team played up to their potential this game.
Hell no.
I mean, if that makes any sense. LDLC made a whole lot of mistakes, but then so did ESG. I mean, that was a very wishy-washy, all-over-the-place game. Nail-biting, of course, we get to the 30th round, but that was really just all over the place, that game.
All right, well, guys, that's going to put us into the last game of the evening, which is Epsilon versus ESG, coming up in about, 10 minutes, guys, so don't go anywhere. We'll be right back after these commercials. Remember to follow the channel and subscribe to us and all that stuff. Really do appreciate it, but we'll be right back after.